Hey, welcome to episode 3 of the Between Two Beers podcast. Today we talked to former All White Che Bunce. This was a great chat, about an hour and a half, covered a lot of ground. Bunce's sort of 15 club career, his time with the All Whites, the turbulent time at the Knights. We talk about how we actually fell out at WaikatoFC when he was the coach and I was a player, following a very successful year as a strike partnership at Melville. We talked about the tough transition into the real world after he finished his career, and we talk about the party on the plane of Waikato United in 1996. So a lot of great stuff there. Really enjoyed this hour and a half chat. If you like what we're doing at Between Two Beers, make sure you give our Facebook page a like and a follow. We actually lost half our followers for some reason last week, so make sure you are liking us, because that's where we're going to be clipping out all the best bits and posting them. So hope you enjoyed this chat. Here you go. Che Bunce, welcome to Between Two Beers.
G'day, nice to be here. Thanks for having me.
Buncey is the third guest we've had on the show, following Aaron Scott and Paul Nixon, two great episodes if you haven't checked them out. But he's the first guest to request a beer. Now, Che and I are on the Stoke Pilsners tonight, but Buncey, what are you drinking?
Heineken Zero. Yeah.
0%?
Yes, it is.
Talk us through it. What's going on?
I can't handle my liquor, basically. Never have been, and only took me 40 years to realise that. So I thought I'll stick to Heineken Zero, just in case I say something silly tonight.
I actually picked these up. I was going to, in the liquor shop around the corner, they've actually got Fiji Bitters and Fiji Golds, and I thought, in honour of your Fijian tournaments, maybe roll back the years and get a couple of Fijian beers in, but I've stuck to what you requested, and I've got the Heineken Zeros. Yeah.
Oh, thanks. Yeah, good times in Fiji, actually. So
maybe we'll delve into it a bit later.
Yeah, by all means.
The way we like to do things at Between Two Beers is we intro the guests by telling the audience how we know them, bring them in the frame of reference. So, Che, how do you know Buncey?
Probably less well than you do. Buncey was a photo in the Hamilton Boys High reception, manned by Barbara Clark. There's a photo of Che and there's a photo of JP. And I moved to Hamilton in 96, and they were kind of, I almost want to say, heroes, because
JP is Jerry
shout out to Jezza. Jonathan Perry. Right. So kind of almost like my first football heroes, to be quite honest.
Yeah.
And I'd never met him. And then my next interaction was WaikatoFC steering committee with Gordon Glenn Watson, and we wrote to you when you were at Randers, and we were trying to, you probably don't remember this.
I didn't remember you wrote to me.
No, Gordy did.
Yeah, I remember that. Yeah. About fitness programs or something?
That was part of it, but also around just trying to get the franchise, an endorsement for the franchise to get the license for that first season.
Yeah.
And then I kind of just met you hanging around the traps. Yeah. And I famously, maybe last year, I think, in a five-a-side chat, Buncey didn't realise that I'd played football before. I was quite upset about that. But look,
what position were you playing at the time?
At the time I was retired, and it was a five, and I refused to play anywhere other than in goal. But after
it's funny what you say, you don't realise that
apologies. No, not at all, because funnily enough, after 90 seconds on the court, I went straight into goal and I couldn't move. so that was a long time ago, but that's kind of Buncey.
I grew up in the Roger Wilkinson Centre of Excellence era, where Buncey was kind of the poster child for success in Hamilton football. Yeah. Much like you, I grew up through Hamilton Boys High, so I saw the picture of Buncey, and I would have been about 10 when Buncey signed for Sheffield United in the Premier League, so I think it was a two-year contract. So that was the talk. I remember quite vividly Buncey being like the one, the path to follow. It's possible if you,
you know, train right under Rog, because he had a big part in your development, that this is what you can achieve. And then, yeah, you sort of bounced around the globe a bit. I think we didn't really reconnect. We might have played a bit of head tennis now and then when you were back with Sam Wilkinson. But I think you got injured and then you came back as an assistant coach to Professor Steve Williams for a season at Melville that I was playing.
Yeah, wow.
And then we really got to know each other better in 2009, which was the Melville
great season,
title-winning season.
Yeah, again, this is the one you guys talk about, but it wasn't a real Northern League. Well, the Northern Federation clubs weren't in the league.
Because there was a final, wasn't there?
Yeah,
again. We won the final, and there was a trophy.
Yeah.
I guess arguably too, if you go there, we didn't actually win the league, we won the final, right? So that's another thing.
Yeah, thank you for cutting through the...
But I think we did score a mountain full of goals.
We did.
I think, to be fair, no disrespect to those Northern teams, but the best teams were this side of the bridge, right? I mean, maybe bar Glenfield Rovers.
Yeah, I think the North Shore teams were quite weak at that point. But yeah, we're going to get into...
But all that meant is that the players that were playing there just came to clubs on the other side, so it didn't lose any strength.
Yeah, yeah. So we're claiming it. Yeah. So it was.
It wasn't.
So yeah, we formed a strike, an unlikely, I'd say, strike partnership, which I think we were the two top scorers in the league that year. I beat you because I took all the penalties.
Glad you conceded that. I was going to mention that.
Yeah,
but
I knew it was coming.
I probably mentioned it a lot throughout the season.
Strong defence.
Yeah.
And then,
you had eight games on me because I started late in the season, but we won't mention that.
We have mentioned it, but we won't mention it again.
Delve a bit deeper.
And then there was 2010 where you were coach Waikato FC and I had a small role to play, and then our sort of paths diverged.
We're not going to talk about that, are we?
Well, I think we should.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Delve into that.
All right.
Because you two obviously were there. I can only go on hearsay.
Yeah.
And
what was your hearsay? Is it your hearsay is from Stephen?
Oh, look, I'm piecing different parts of the of the puzzle together and I'm forming a picture here, but the way I
think this is the first time we've actually talked properly since then.
Maybe if
that's going to give indication how the story went.
Yeah. But. I'm glad that we've been able to mediate this. Look, cut a long story short, I've heard Stephen was a big gun, refused to travel to Christchurch to sit on the bench, and basically walked out on the club, and that started the downward spiral that was Waikato FC, and eventually morphed into YBOP.
Yes,
that's a lot.
And you know, for the all time leading scorer to walk out on the club, especially you know when his hero, let's not mince words, his hero was coaching.
Jeez.
Yeah, and I can see that I can see the discomfort on both of you. So
this is great. I'd love to talk about it.
Well, maybe let's get the player's side first, and then.
Well, yeah, I've had a bit of time since we decided to bring Buncey on. I had a bit of time this afternoon actually to reflect on what happened over that period, and at the time I remember quite vividly thinking Buncey was a twat. What he fucking hell, he treated me poorly. But now when I've gone back and I've looking and I'm remembering it and I'm thinking, I was like, well, what's the story I'm going to tell? What basically happened was I didn't have my heart set on playing National League that season, but I committed to it. I remember talking to Buncey about playing and being the main man, all that sort of stuff. And then I think I went on a Northern League All-Stars tour to Australia for a couple of weeks, and came back, and it might have been the second or third game of the season, and Mike Gwyther and Dan Peat had been playing quite well, and so they were the starting strikers. And I was living at Mount Maunganui at the time.
They were probably quite sharp from playing in the Northern...
The proper Northern League
in the winter season before that.
So I was living at Mount Maunganui at the time, so I was travelling over for trainings twice or three times, I can't remember. And then... It got to when I was back from Australia, we had an away game against Canterbury, and I was thinking, shit, I'm going to have to drive from the Mount to Hamilton to go to the airport to catch a flight to
classic,
Canterbury
classic
to sit on the bench and maybe get 10 minutes at the end, and I'm lucky, and then come back. And my heart wasn't really in it. So I was like, I remember calling, I was like, Buncey, I'm not going to sit on the bench. I'm not going to Canterbury to sit on the bench. I'm just not.
Yeah.
So I was right. And I remember you saying, have a very hard think about this because there's no going back when you know, like, oh, Buncey, I'm not changing my mind. I'll come if I'm starting, but I'm not coming to sell the pitch.
If a player says that. Yeah.
And I think it showed that my heart was in it. So, but I remember thinking from that discussion, you know what, I haven't really done anything wrong here. But now when I retell the story, I think I can accept that maybe 24-year-old Steve perhaps wasn't the mature decision-maker he is now.
Oh, listen, I've made many a mistake as a player and done things I shouldn't have done. And I'd actually forgotten about it. And now it's bringing back memories, and there's a little bit more to it than that. And I mean, that season was a tough year for me, being my first year as a player coach, or as a first year as a coach in the National League. So I learned a lot. It's a pity that I actually, you know, your first year is always your hardest, and especially with a club like Waikato FC, where you had no support or no backing. We won't go into that and the people involved with that club, but you know, they were volunteers, they did their best, but. I certainly pissed off a lot of players, probably including yourself, but and if I've got any regrets, there are a lot from that season. And I do remember I'd come from a professional environment to what was really an amateur environment, right? And I made the mistake, and your mate Sam Wilkinson, you know, he left as well, you know, because I thought I'd run it like a professional team, put my team up on the board. Like they do in a pro club.
Yeah.
If you're in the team, you're in the team. If you're not, you're in reserves, you get on with it. But obviously, when you don't get paid, it's not your living. They can just see you later. but I remember the that now you've said it about your situation. What actually happened, Seamus, was Stephen had actually been trying to get into the big clubs. He neglected to say that. He wanted to sign for Auckland City and Waitakere, who... didn't want him in the end.
It's good. Let's speak some truths on this.
And he went on it was a Northern League select tour to Australia. And I didn't realize. And you're right. You know, it would have been a really hard call to for me. I remember getting the call, so I couldn't believe it. Saying, "Am I going to start? Because I'm not going to come down to last year." And that was the first game of the season. I'm thinking, "Oh my god, this job's hard enough as it is." And I can't remember what I said to you, and I like just maybe said you'd have to make the call because we had Dan Pete, who was actually playing quite well, and that's what we won the first game, hadn't we? Mm. I think it's the only game we won for 10 weeks. And then you said and like you said, you probably your heart really wasn't. You probably wanted to play for those other teams, or you wanted to rate your being a poker magnet in the mount or something. So
there
was a little bit of edginess from there, you know. You know, I thought I could rely on my good my Waikato lads, but I understood that. That's why I think you were up front with me, saying, "Listen, I want to try and get in the Auckland City squad, and why not? You're going from a Waikato FC team with zero resources to a team that's challenging for the, you know, the NZFC and the World Club Championship." So I thought, fair play. But when you didn't get in, you came back and said, "No, I can't be bothered turning from the mount." That was running it. So that was an interesting time.
Yeah, it's about the end of the... Well, I played for YTAC after that, kind of, but it was basically...
Yeah, I mean, it was basically it's more just the interview at YTAC, isn't it? With the eyebrows. If you get a chance to... Yeah. I'll probably link it in again after this.
Is it on YouTube?
Yeah, it is on YouTube.
Nice, look.
Buncey, there's a few others. Joel Mathews, you had a run-in with him at Waikato. What happened there?
Yeah, well, to be honest, if we talked about this already, but... You know, I said that I learned a lot, and there was a few regrets. And if I've got any regrets, it would be from I did have a run-in with him, and to be fair, I'm remorseful what I ripped into him. You know, it was way over the top and out of line. And to be fair to him, you know, he took him to the left, and I don't blame. But like, if I saw him now in the street, I would apologise for the way I took him because it was out of line, and I think it was born out of my frustrations at the time. Yeah, so I think if he's listening, you know, if I see him in the street, I'll apologise to his face and say, "Hey, that was bad," because he was, you know, he's a decent lad, and you know, I think the whole incident was, it was maybe a case of him not really being keen to play for the team, because I think one of his mates wasn't in the team as well. I didn't select one of his mates, but yeah, it was an interesting period. And yeah, I think if I had my time again, I wouldn't have said what I'd said to him.
I was talking to Joel before the pod, and we were sort of going back over a few memories, and his telling of the story was that he was juggling a financial career and travel from Auckland to Narrawarrie, and it got into, he was wearing a suit and you had a go at him for, because he was a bit late because of traffic or whatever, and he said that it took him, you called him out for taking too long to get changed out of his suit, and so he had it in his head that fuck Buncey, whatever it was, and then he sort of had a bit of beef during the training session, and then it ended up with a big row at the end, and you went offered him, as you said,
over the top. It was,
but what a slightly humorous twist to it was, one of the things you said was you're unfit to wear this jersey, part of your rant. And then it got out in the paper, and I saw the article the other day, and it said Joel Mathews was dropped for being unfit, and he took and he took offence to that, and so he said he got pissed up one night, and he called, I think it must have been James Raffin, the media officer, and said, "I'm doing you for defamation. I was fit. I was the fittest player in that team. That's not how things went." Yeah. Pathetic.
Oh. Isn't it funny though? Like, the media can take things, you know, they can take whatever they want and mix it up, and it can take things out of context.
But that's why we never edit the podcast. we just let it go natural.
But but fun, you know, it was funny. But
how much of that season were you playing? Because you were player coach.
Yeah, I played and coached the whole time. It was tough, you know. And I had very little support.
Yeah, who was your assistant?
I had Kevin O'Leary, who was the assistant at the Knights, but he was based in Auckland, and he wouldn't come down for all the sessions. But as far as back rooms, we had nothing. You know, we had James Raffin sort of sitting in his room playing PlayStation most of the time, you know. Nice guy, but, you know, he wasn't, you know, he didn't have the resources it was, and I remember
was Ray talking Paul of the shirt. Around?
Yeah, Ray Paul floated around.
Yeah. Was it the famous wolf shirts?
Yeah, those shirts that I think they spent about $20,000 to make.
Suno.
Yeah, so they were those. That season, I mean, it's funny I say he wasn't fit enough to wear the shirt, because I think they spent about $25,000, you know, of grant money to this company, Suno, right? And they were specially designed fabric from here, handmade in New Zealand.
So it's possible he wasn't fit enough to wear the shirt.
Part of the deal was that slim they would, the money covered this wrapping that would go around the outside of the pitch, you know, it was this thin sort of wrapping. And that cost a few $1,000s as well, and it was advertising. They put it up, and on the day that they put it up, gust of wind came, and it just flapped, and then there was just bits of plastic flapping over. Like, it was so thin, it was just, and they spent thousands on it. It was part of the shirt deal. That season was Mickey Mouse, and
those orange shirts are still floating around. You can still find them every now and again.
Yeah.
If you look hard enough.
But I do, and it's funny, like, you hear the perspective now, like, it's, you know, as you get older, like, everything can be sorted with communication, just talking to people. And, like, you know, if he'd said to me that he's feeling, if I'd asked him, you know what I mean, like, those lads that play for me, like, travelling from Auckland, it's hard, yeah. Like, they come straight from work. They don't get home till 10:30 at night. Yeah. Got to go to work early morning. It's hard work.
Yeah, we had Azza on here in the first podcast.
Yeah, he did it for a long time, right?
Five times a week going up to Waitak, and he had a fridge in his car and all sorts of crazy
commitment,
stuff.
Commitment, eh? You've got to morrow. But how bad is it that he's needing to do that? Like, you know, well, why isn't he playing National League in Hamilton?
Yeah.
And Waikato.
Well, we've lost.
I asked him. He wouldn't play for me, but. But what, you know, they were top of the league.
Yeah, but Waitakere. We all felt that way at some point.
Wasn't the first one, eh? There's a long list. Take the hint. Yeah. Should I ask you, Seamus?
You didn't know I played,
I know. Damn it. Yeah. I needed a good goalkeeper, too.
Who'd you have? Jason Mann. Friend of the show. I'm just making it up now. Yeah. Greg Walters.
Scotty Robinson.
Scotty Robinson.
No, he wasn't there.
He was RGK.
I had... Oh.
It was Sean Dowling.
Yes. What's Sean Dowling?
Because he also played in the final of the Not Northern League
when Melville won the title.
Well, Melville won the final.
For the other team, was it Bay Olympic or something?
Eastern Suburbs.
Eastern.
Yeah, my favourite.
No. It was Bay Olympic, wasn't it?
Nah, Eastern Suburbs.
Sean Dowling, friend of the show.
I know who we were. They were quite strong, though, weren't they?
Yeah, Alan Pearce.
Sean Douglas. Was
Graham
there.
Pearce. Douglas.
Yeah, yeah.
Graham Pearce, yeah.
You've got good players, eh? Pearce brothers.
Yeah. Good physio.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. No, they're good players.
Alan's a good physio, so that all balances out.
Is he involved with the All Whites? And
nah, he's started his own practice on the shore and new father. And
happens to him. Roland Jeffrey's.
What a man.
Physio, for years, he would have some stories. He's got inside knowledge. You know everything.
If you're listening, Roland, we would love to have you on the podcast.
Great guy, too. Yep.
Great guy.
Mm.
Yeah.
Was he the one
we can talk about stories off air about you know, like just, you know, the physio room where you come in and the massage room.
Yeah.
Many a good yarn on tours.
That's where I spent most of my time.
On physio room.
On tours.
It doesn't surprise me.
Not getting treated just in just the corner listening.
So we're gonna bounce around a lot to cover, but I want to go back a year. We're going to start with the year we played together at Melville, because
happier times.
It was a great time. It was a great year.
Because we did go from really happy time. It was a great season.
We did. And we were a really good partnership up front. Yeah.
Is this are we back on track now? Have we healed the wounds?
We didn't really have a lot. I think just because we went separate ways, but I didn't have a lot to do with Stephen after that.
Yeah.
And we never hugged and made up, but
I think we're cool, Bunce.
Totally cool.
I mean, I've invited you on the podcast, the third guest. Although he did not, he wasn't impressed. He did text me when I asked him, and he said, "Are you fucking kidding me? What, Aaron Scott and Paul Nixon before me?"
Yeah. Yeah.
Thanks for mentioning that.
Yeah.
Sorry, Nico and Aaron, if you listen to this.
They don't listen. Nico doesn't know what podcast is still.
So 2009.
Yep.
You've had this career. You were Coventry a couple of years ago. You're 34. You're the age I am now. And I think you played the first game, was it maybe Papatoa away, and you were centre back. And I think Steve and a few others were sort of saying, "Look, we've got Buncey here. Is he wasted at centre back? Maybe he's not that into it. Should we try putting him up front?" And so you had an outstanding year, from transitioning from a career as a centre back to playing up front. How was that?
Yeah, that was weird, eh? I just remember the game. I think it was a home game, I thought. And he just said, I think it's because I came into the squad slightly late. So he had started his team and I was on the bench, and I think he went 0-0 and he needed a goal. And I think Steve said, "Oh, sure, I'll throw you up front." And I said, "Yeah, I'm keen for that. I'd rather play up front than the back." To be fair, at Northern League, you're sort of standing around waiting for the ball to get
It wasn't Northern League. It was all. I'm not going to let this go.
What was it called then? Anyway, chucked it. I think scored a goal. Never looked back. Right, and then we linked in. We were scoring goals for fun. Right, it was like I'll score one, you'll score one. I'll set up a penalty, you'd score the penalty, sort of thing. And we had a little Dwight York thing going there for a while, which worked a treat. Yeah.
Was there any part, what is
the Dwight York thing?
Well, it's a little move that Andy Cole and Dwight York used to do at Man United really well. Well, they'd just one dummy over the ball and then spin and get the return.
The old Kiwi.
No, the Kiwi's little takeover, isn't it?
I'm just saying things.
If you play football, you can.
Yeah, exactly. Bruce Holloway famously thinks you're the best striker that ever played at Melville.
Well, that's what I was going to ask. I think
it's a compliment, if anything.
Steve, he was
established already.
At 34,
his credentials are.
You've come in and you've dominated the league as a striker. Is there any part of you, obviously you've had such a great career as a centre back, was there any part of you at the end that thought, "Shit, maybe I could have had a go here earlier"?
Well, funny you say that, because when I was 19 or 20, I went on trial at Crewe Alexander in the pre-season, and I was actually signed up on a week-by-week contract, and I was there for about 2.5 months. They had a pre-season friendly against Liverpool, and all the strikers were injured, and the Dario Gatti, the manager, was going to play me up front against Liverpool. And I was like, wow, unbelievable. Like, I guess because I was tall on it. And long story short, they tried me at striker against a youth team, and I just ran around like a mad ass fly and didn't get anywhere near the ball, so they changed their mind, so I didn't play. But if I'd done okay in that, I would have played against and that was the year with it was sort of late 90s, so it was a good Liverpool side. Stan Collymore, he was playing that area, and there's a lot, if you could, I'd be interested to know what players there, but it was a good Liverpool side. But it's one of those what could have been.
That was the Spice Boys era, 99.
Oh, was it?
Yeah. Your Jason McAteer's, your Phil Babbs, your John Scales.
Robbie Fowler, Jamie Redknapp.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
John Barnes, my hero, would have been good looking. Sorry, my other hero.
Yeah.
My non-Hamilton boys high football hero.
The glory days. I'm glad we try to mention the 2009 Melville league win every podcast, so I'm glad we got that in the early doors.
Nice.
Buncey, I'm going to skip ahead. I'm just going to read through because I've been doing a bit of research on you this afternoon. So I'm on your Wikipedia page. I'm going to read through the number of clubs you played at, according to Wikipedia. Sheffield United, Napier City Rovers, Melville United, Crewe Alexandra, Biederblick, Football Kings, Biederblick, Drogheda United, Randers FC, Waikato, New Zealand Knights, Coventry City, Navua, Waikato, Melville United, Hawke's Bay, Melville United, Waikato, and 29 caps for the All Whites.
Yeah.
It's quite a lot of clubs there, isn't it? It's quite there's a lot of reasons why you sort of bounced around.
A bit of a footballing gypsy, really.
Yeah, you could say that. But I want to zone in on the sort of 2005 to 2007 period. So you did 2 years at Waikato, and then you're at the Knights for one season, and then you got signed for Coventry. Now, Coventry were in the Championship at the time. Mm-hmm. You were 32, I think.
31.
31?
Yeah.
That was arguably the biggest club you ever played for right at the end. Mm. So talk me through how you went from basically the National League to the Knights to getting perhaps the biggest contract of your career after perhaps struggling with the Knights.
So we touched on a little bit when I actually was assistant coach at Melville. I had a back injury. I was out of the game for almost 2 years I had back surgery and everything, so it was a tough time. When I came right, I went and played for Drogheda in Ireland, the Summer League, and I stayed there and wasn't happy. Had a great time, Dublin, fantastic city, but the footballing was lacking in an area. So, and that's when I signed for Randers in Denmark. And that was arguably one of my best clubs. Like, as far as financially and prestige, it was the second tier of Denmark, not huge, but great standard of football. And the reason I left there is because, we got promoted that season to the top league. Larissa, my wife, got pregnant, and so it was like, right, this call the day to come back to New Zealand. So I was 29 then, and my back was right after being, off for 2 years, and I was at the peak of my, I think 29, 30, you're at the peak of your career because you've still got your pace, you're strong and you've got a bit of game sense about you. And so that's when I thought, right, fair enough, Larissa sort of followed me around the whole world for 10 years. We've been together since, we were really young. So I thought, oh, baby's born, so we want to be back in New Zealand. And it's probably the worst time to come back to New Zealand because I was at the peak of my, the peak of my football. And that's when I ended up playing for, Waikato FC because, Dick and Ed was coach and we had a, you played as well, for one season.
I don't think I've ever played with you.
Yeah.
I don't think. Oh, we might have crossed.
Yeah, because we had Cole Tinkler, Sammy Wilkins and Maney. It was a good,
You were in the States. Yeah, no, I was in the States. I did play for Rod, but I think you were meant to play one season but didn't for some reason.
So anyway, from there I sort of played for the and that's when the Knights sort of came to fore, right? And I missed that first season. John Edson was coach and then Paul Nevin became the coach, and Paul Nevin, fantastic guy and coach, doing great things now, right, at Brighton. Involved with the England setup as well, so amazing guy and amazing dude. And then he gave me my break back at the Knights. And then had a good, that was one of my best seasons in a long time at the Knights, I think. The team didn't do very well, but it was a great season. And then, like you say, I'm at 30, 31. The shit happened at the Knights, which we could probably touch on if you want to. There was a lot of controversy with that. The club we were left all without the contract sort of gone. And that's when I had a trial with Dundee United and Coventry City. And it was one of the, like the greatest nights of my life. I've been a footballer. I've had so many trials at different clubs all around the world, around the UK and the world. And then I had a trial at Dundee United. And we played a reserve game against Rangers. And there was a scout from Coventry City there watching at the same time. And so had a reasonable game, and then got onto the bus, and then the Dundee United manager, or the assistant manager, said, "Oh, you did really well. We're going to offer you a contract." I'm delighted, you know. Great Premier League, Scottish Premier League, great. And on the way, and as we're driving 1 hour back back to Dundee, get a phone call from an agent saying, Coventry City has scout there watching, they want to sign you. I'm like, wow. Why did this happen when I'm 31? Unbelievable, you know. I was over the moon, so it was one of the best nights of my life to get that phone call.
The value
call.
Of having an agent. Yeah. For anyone out there that's making players out there.
Yeah, maybe. Del Powell actually was my agent, so I used to play for Derby County. Knew Scott Gemmell. And that all came about from, and that was another thing, Scott Gemmell, if you remember him, played for the Knights, played for Everton, played alongside Roy Keane.
Yeah.
New poor Gascoigne. He had some great banter, some great stories. But his father, the Archie Gemmell, the famous Archie, he watched the game and he actually recommended me to Darryl Powell as the agent and to the club. So I kind of got there on that recommendation. He saw one game. It's actually the game where Ricky Herbert just came back in charge and we flew over to Sydney UFC and beat them 1-0, which was a real upset. So I scored the winner. As a centre back, went up for a corner. That's how I scored all my goals, you know, from corners. Yeah. So.
Well, famously didn't get that one against Brazil at the Conference Cup 99.
That's haunted me for a long time.
Really?
Yeah.
Was that peak of your powers, Bunce, that 99?
No, I was 24. So it wasn't really.
Yeah.
Still, that was only my second year in the All White setup.
Oh, right.
Yeah, it was. So
just linking back to Coventry. Mm. So you signed for Coventry, what was the length of the contract and what were the terms and things like that?
It was only to the rest of the season. So I got there in January and just signed through to August. And again, that one I had to decide right what contract to take. And Dundee had flown me from New Zealand, paid me, he had put me up for a week. And then there's this Coventry City came in the final hour. But Adrian Heath was the manager. And he was an Everton striker. Yep. He was my hero. I was just for Everton as a kid, and he's wanting to sign me. Larissa had a good mate that lived in Coventry, you know. And Championship is, you know, arguably better than the Premier League.
I imagine there would have been some teammates earning some pretty big bucks at that time. An 8-month contract at a Championship club. Is that, like, at the end of your career, is that enough to sort of set you up for life? Like, how much money were you talking?
It gave me a decent chunk of money for the time that it was there. You know, without going into detail, I mean, there was players there at that time, and it's funny how, you know, what was that, 2006, I think, or 2007, how things have changed so quickly. I think the highest championship player was Dwight York at Sunderland, who was getting £20,000. I think the top player, the highest paid player in Coventry City was on about 10. That probably would have been Lee Hughes, I think his name, used to play for Arsenal. Yeah. It was Don Hutchinson. I mean, yeah, they go there in the car parks, Bentleys and, you know, Range Rover Sport. They're all, you know,
What were you driving?
A Toyota.
Corolla.
Similar. Yeah. Avensis. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I was thinking of splashing out and getting an X5, you know, but, oh, why not? But, yeah. Nah.
So
diesel-powered Avensis.
Yeah. So 8 months there, but you didn't get any game time. Was that difficult, or did you know quite early doors that you weren't going to really?
It was again. Football's quite fickle, eh? Like, I was, on the bench to start with, you know, doing well and training and things, and then I had the captain and another player at centre back in front of me, and just waiting your time, really. And then one player, this captain, got a red card, and he said to me in the bus, "Bunce, you're on next week, you know, you get into it." And then the very next day, Adrian Heath gets the sack, and Ian Dowie comes in and manages the team.
Oh, wow.
And decides that he won't even put me in the squad, you know, of the 18. And to be fair to me, he said, "Listen, you're from New Zealand. I know all the English players. I know their pedigree. I know exactly what they're like. I don't know you, so I'm going to go for. I've got a week to prepare. I'm going to pick." That's fair enough.
Did any part of you want to ring him and ask him if you were going to start and then threaten to
I'm not travelling to Sunderland because, you know,
I would have travelled if I was on the money, Bunce.
If he'd been contracted, although you were contracted, but anyway.
I think
it was $100 a win and nothing if you lost. So, but anyway, but Ian Dowie didn't have any luck under him, but I still thought he was a fantastic coach. You know, he's an interesting guy, actually. Yeah.
Oh, good. Yeah. I just wanted to loop to the start of your career now. 19-year-old Buncey signs for 2 years with Sheffield United. 17-year-old Buncey signs for 2 years with Sheffield United.
So that was the day, one of the other happiest days of my life, is when I got to fill out my leaving form at Boys High. I said, see you later, I'm out of here.
Is it because you got suspended for the brown eye?
Yeah, I actually got suspended 3 times from Boys High.
Do your lawyer friends know about this past?
I think so. Like only one of them was justified. The brown eye thing, I still don't think that was justified.
Was it a full brown eye or a Mooney?
It was really a Mooney.
Yeah.
And it was over the Kaimais. Yeah. Like, to the other bus, the other school bus.
Oh, back of the bus,
man.
Yeah.
Exactly. Eh? And so it was just overtook the other school bus, doing Mooney to them. And actually, it was a school exchange in Tauranga Boys High. Yeah. I had the game of my life. I scored three, we won 3-0.
Was the first 15 bus behind, or was just another, the hockey, was, or?
Yeah.
Or just the bus of tourists?
No, it was our school.
Our school bus.
Our school, yeah.
It was the first to get me too, I think.
That was, yeah.
But there's a big difference between the Mooney and the brown eye. If it's a brown eye.
There were no butt cheek spread.
Anyway.
They'd have to have a good eye for that, excuse the pun, to see that.
Yeah.
You know, overtake on the bendy Kaimos at pace, you know. Yeah. But that was the last year of the cane. They had still the cane. Hard to believe now you're thinking about the cane. Like,
yeah.
And I thought I was going to get, they said, you're in shit, you're going to get the cane. So on the way, I was borrowing the other lads. I had about 6 pairs of shorts on, the exercise book, ready for the cane.
Wow.
And when I got off, they said, you're suspended, and suspended indefinitely. So it was massive.
So that was the third strike. That was the third.
No, that was the first one. That
expelled, I think. Is it suspended indefinitely?
No, it's basically, no, you go to the front of the board of trustees or whatever it was back then,
yeah,
and you have a review and stuff.
Did they do any sort of recreation? Amateur recreation.
Recreation. Yeah, it's all cross-examined. Yeah, let's have a look at your butt cheeks.
Oh, gosh.
Yeah, so anyway.
What were the other two suspensions for?
The other one was, there was the same teacher that suspended me, and he's an absolute ass, so we may have to edit this, but a guy called Mr. Russ, and he had a big moustache, and he used to get called Walrus by everybody. Mm. I shout out Walrus.
We've done that actually to Jeremy Field, but that's a different Walrus.
And so I got suspended for yelling Walrus. The other one, I decked the guy, and that deserved a suspension. I regret that one.
Is it a bit of a violent streak?
I'm not really a violent person, but when I, you know, when I'm in the game and stuff, I can be, and when I get worked up, but that was my mate's fault. He wound me up. This guy hit me up in the classroom by the throat, and my mate was going, Buncey, you can't let him get away with that, you know, he's just made you look like a fool, you can't do that, you got to sort him out. And I'm thinking,
Yeah, you're right.
And then so after class, I just went up the nose, we walloped him straight in the face. He's down on the ground, blood coming out. And my mate's going, oh my God, Buncey, what are you doing?
I can't believe you've done that.
And he's right, and it was terrible. You know, it wasn't fine. It's terrible. It's not my thing, but
okay.
One of those mistakes. Anyway, moving on.
Tough teenage years, but you got to Sheffield United when you were 17.
Yes.
So, sorry, is that sixth form in the old vernacular?
Yeah, it was old sixth form, year 12, the end of sixth form. I left at 17.
You left school to trial?
Yeah.
Or just you left school?
I had a 6-week trial. Roger Wilkinson set it up, went along with another guy who played at Waikato United in those days, Glenn Green.
Glenn Green came
with me. Well done. We trialled for 6 weeks, and then they offered me a 2-year apprenticeship back then.
Mm.
So, and that was the first year of the Premier League. And Sheffield United were in the Premier League then, and then they got relegated the year that I left.
Brian Dean scored the first goal in the Premier League.
Yeah.
For Sheffield United.
Hell of a nice guy too, Brian Dean. Came back and played for Perth Glory.
Good knowledge. So how tough is that 2 years as a 17-year-old with no family support, and you're there competing with other teenagers trying to get a gig, cutthroat?
Incredibly tough. Hard. I know I used to, you know, almost cry myself in the pillow at night. I was so lonely and homesick. And when I come back at Christmas and the Christmas break, well, you know, I got 2 weeks back home. Actually, I tell a lie, didn't it? It was in the off season. So Christmas Day, I was staying in digs, you know, virtually with strangers by myself on Christmas Day. But anyway, I came back in between the seasons, and I said to my parents, I don't want to go back. You know, I hate it. I'm homesick. And they sort of said, looking back, it's funny because mum and dad obviously you know, as parents, you know, now you probably know it's pretty hard to send your kids off, right?
Mm-hmm.
You're probably saying, yeah, stay here. But they made a selfless decision and said, give it another couple of months, see how you go, and you can come back. And I did, and, you know, sort of found my groove and loved it, you know, and then was fine. But it very tough, like the European football, English is tough, you know, working class people. It's a dog-eat-dog world, you know, everybody's, you're all fighting for a professional contract. So it was tough, you know. So
is teenage Buncey getting called into New Zealand squads and coming back for those qualifiers, or
Roger had me involved. He had me involved with under 19s when I was 16, right? So, and again, all these things help, right? If you get that on your CV, that sort of helped me get into Sheffield United, I think, plus the trialing. And then when I came back, I was involved with my 2 years. I didn't get a pro contract, so I came back to New Zealand, and then from there, that's when I got into the under 19 setup. The Alan Jones and Roger.
Yep.
And then went to Fiji on my first trip, actually, and had many more trips to Fiji after there for football.
Famously in 2008 with Matt Williams and Michael Main.
Yes.
Navua's first Battle of the Giants.
Yeah, scary that you know so much.
I was at the airport when you arrived back.
Oh, were you?
Yeah, coincidentally.
Press conference, were you?
I just think I was... No. I had nothing to do that day.
Yeah.
Let's get into your All White stuff. So, 29 caps... 29?
Yeah.
Yep.
Yep.
When you look back at your All Whites career, what do you think about it? Do you think you fulfilled your potential? Do you have any regret?
No, I don't think I have any regrets. So, like, I retired in 07 from the All Whites and started in 98, 99, so sort of 8, 9 years almost, and only played 29 games. And I played one game on New Zealand soil for New Zealand, that's a bit sad, really, you know. And that was against it was in Palmy North against South Korea, you know, and was about 1,000 people there. So nowadays, actually at the moment, we're not getting many games, but yeah. You know, over the, you know, sort of around the World Cup era when we got there, we were playing lots of games, getting lots of tours.
Yeah.
Loved my, you know, I had the 2 years injured as well, which I missed out on the Confederations Cup in France. But it was France, wasn't it? Yeah. Which would have been, you know, that's a disappointment, but. Otherwise, I love every moment, you know.
Did you play in the Brazil 06 in Switzerland game?
Yes, I did.
Yeah.
Did. I was a sub that got subbed.
Oh, sub.
Yeah. I did. It was. Oh. So I was on the bench, and to start with, obviously, and Danny Hay got injured after 15 minutes. It's like, yes, get in there. I'm coming off. You know. And then I'm playing through, and then Mossy punched me in the head, went for the ball. Fisted me in the side of the head, so I was down bleeding. And I'm thinking, I'm the sub that's going to get subbed here because the physio's got this. I'm like, on the right, just bandage me up. I'm staying on. Plus, I wanted to swap shirts, you know, as well. So
did you get a shirt in
there? No, I didn't. I didn't because my white shirt was covered in blood. So I don't think the Brazilians were that keen on swapping anyway.
Yeah.
That was a bit of a, to be honest, if I look back, that was a bit embarrassing. We had teammates sort of walking into the dressing room, waiting for the players to come out of the showers to get the shirt. I'm like, how demeaning is that, right? If they want to swap in the game, swap, but you don't go chase them into changing rooms. But maybe I'm just jealous because I didn't get a shirt. But
and were you on the famous Costa Rica Venezuela tour?
I was. Yeah. How do you know about that?
All White's insider.
Yeah, I reckon. Geez, you know, it's scary.
What do you know? Well, I know it was a tough tour. I mean, the results on the pitch, I think, were 4-0 and 5-0. Costa Rica and Paraguay. And it goes down famously when you talk to kind of All White staffers and former players as one of the most difficult tours. I think that the journey home was 50 hours or something.
It was a disaster.
Players sleeping in airports and all sorts of...
Leaving there in Venezuela, the plane just was late. Got later, delayed, and then there's just not coming.
Commercial flight or a private flight?
I think so.
Yeah,
just not coming.
And Caracas, Steve, is one of the most dangerous cities in the world.
Really? I mean, we were only there for three nights. It was a whistle stop. But apparently, obviously, you probably know this, but the host nation pays and organises the flights.
Yeah.
And they just didn't bother. And I think New Zealand football had to hastily rearrange.
Yeah.
And I remember... Yeah, we're waiting around because the worst thing is you play the game, get back to hotel at 11, you go to sleep at 2, and we had to get up at like 4 to get to the airport to get the flight.
I had to do that many times.
Yeah, and to do that, and because there's FIFA rules, you have to be back within 48 hours.
Yeah. Where were you playing at that?
Coventry City.
Yeah.
So I didn't get back in time, so, and I wasn't involved, and that didn't help my, you know, and it has a flow on effect. I couldn't, wasn't be able to be selected for my game. So there you go, you know, you missed out on the game, you lose your place. Shocking. But I remember waiting and waiting. In the end, we ended up going in like a Learjet, private jet.
Oh, wow.
To Panama, then from Panama to New York. We had like four different connecting flights.
Andy Barron's sleeping under a staircase or something like that.
Oh, was he? See, we didn't know because the ones, players that were based in England, there's about six of us, you know, that went on that flight. The rest sort of got, we just all got split. We didn't know what happened, if they were getting home or not. They just said, right, come over here. We walked down. It wasn't like we were going through like an official airport. It was like we were on a tarmac, like a Hamilton airport. Don't even go through customs or anything. We just hopped into this Learjet with, you know, leather seats and stuff. But it was like, when I say a Learjet, it was like 60s sort of, you know, yeah, like drug dealing.
Drug runner.
Yeah, yeah. And then, that was the, for me, that was the icing on the cake that I decided I wasn't going to play for New Zealand again. Yeah, because for my myriad of factors, you know, for the way Ricky Herbert behaved on that tour and leading up to that, and then just the way New Zealand football, like, I remember we stopped in Panama overnight. We're starving. We had a hotel that had been organised, and I think we'd used we had a New Zealand football credit card number that we could use, and
maxed
obviously, but no, but they, and then when we went to have dinner, New Zealand football had cancelled it, crossed it off, so we couldn't eat. They wouldn't let us. You know, you wouldn't use these, your international players who've been stranded for 48 hours. And then they decide that, they don't want us to spend too much money, of their money, or like $100. And we're like, come on, give some trust. We're not going to go get, you know, on a bender and get drunk. And we're absolutely exhausted, you know. So anyway, and that was probably just one person that ticked off. But it was a disaster. Like you say, we lost 4-0. I had played in Costa Rica on a artificial pitch.
That's right. Yeah, I remember watching.
Which was square. It was 100 by 100 meters. It was massive. It was, and it was the old fashioned one too. It wasn't new generation.
Yeah.
And they were decent. And then I didn't play against Venezuela, but I just remember sitting there watching the goal. You know.
So when you retired, I think you quite publicly spoke out about Ricky Herbert, and I think there might have been a few comments from him back. Talk me through the evolution of your relationship with Ricky. Was it good to start with and then it deteriorated? Or?
Yeah, listen, Ricky, I think when Ricky first came on board with the All Whites, he did good things. You know, he brought a bit of mana back to the shirt, and he was really heavily invested. And he, you know, that was his sole focus, and he was a passionate player. He was really passionate about doing things right. And he was, I'd say he was lucky too, because he came at the right time. He had the chairperson or the CEO, I think it was Graham Seater at the time, who was really happy to dish out money and organise games, which was great, which we needed to do. And so a lot of good things happened there. You got Brian Turner involved, who was great. But I think for whatever reason, things sort of tailed off after a year or two, and he had other focuses. And I remember that tour. He was hardly around. His focus was on, that's when the Knights had folded and the Phoenix was coming into existence, and his complete focus was on the Phoenix. And I think, well, you're away for 6 days, you know, come on, put that aside for a while and deal with this.
So you'd been at the Knights, and then you were at Coventry.
Yeah.
In that time.
Yeah.
That time
my period. And I'll go into this detail because I don't want to sound bitter, but this is exactly what happened at the Knights. There was a really bad time for the Knights because they went into at the time. I was loving life at the Knights. You're playing football. I think when you get to the later stages in your football career, you really appreciate how good a job you've got, right? And I'd get in every day early. And there were good people like Neil Eamon, Darren Baisley, Richard Johnson. Cole Tingler wasn't there the year that I was there. Yeah, it's a shame because he's got a great name. And we would play. We'd play head tennis in the corridors and just love playing. The results didn't quite go away because we didn't have the squad. But we actually, Paul Nevin really roughly got fired, and we got Barry Simmons coming. Do you know that name?
Yep. He came in,
and we signed Lele Gao, an ex-Chinese international, was quality, really good player. a guy called a Canadian guy came, I can't recall his name, and we had a few of players, and we had a decent squad. We were just coming right, and then one day came training all locked up, you know, coaches gone, gear man gone, get no balls, nothing, and there's the, you know, representatives from the Australian Football Federation Australia and Ricky Herbert. And so they just took us in a room and said, basically, the club owes thousands, hundred thousands. The club's potentially folded, but we're good guys. You know, we've got Ricky Herbert here who's going to take over the team, and we're going to honour your contract. We're going to give you contracts. We're going to honour your contracts. So that was January, and our contracts were through to August, all through to August. That was the rules. So they gave us these contracts without even telling us, and they were pointing things out, and it was almost like they were forcing. Didn't get any representation of it. They want us to sign them there and then. Pressure, and Ricky Herbert sitting in the back, not saying anything. And the contracts were only to the last game of the season, which was like to March. So basically in that month and a half salary. And the only reason they came to that because they needed the league to continue. Like, if a club falls over, you know. And I was on another year to run my contract. So they asked me to forego, you know, a year and 7 months or 8 months of my contract, which is ludicrous. And basically from there, the shit hit the fan. We questioned it, and then we were really... I was really disappointed in Ricky Hewitt that he didn't look out. He knew this was going on. This had obviously been orchestrated all for a while. You know, Ricky would talk. I saw him at the races, funny enough, and he was saying, you know, how's it all going? And, you know, you could tell he was scheming and scoping for something, you know. And he mentioned me, you know, I was saying, oh, it's a shame that the results. He said, oh, why don't you say something, you know, about the coaches or something like that? And I thought, wow, that's really inappropriate, you know. Just wait your turn, you know, you'll probably get it. So, and what happened there, we basically, that day, we all split. We said, no, we're not signing it. So there was, you know, and then we had Ricky trying to ring up New Zealand players and sort of get them to say, listen, you're going to lose your contract. You need to sign, you know, don't stick as a collective. Mm-hmm. So it was kind of separate the team. Mm-hmm. And I thought it was really difficult because he's a New Zealand coach. We play for New Zealand. We're put in a really bad situation. Can you say no to your Whites coach?
Mm-hmm.
And so that I thought it was a bit rough. And I thought the way the league handled it, they even broke their own transfer regulations because they ended up taking half the squad over to Melbourne. It was Melbourne Victory. And they, if they won that game, they would be minor premiers. They'd win it. So, and they had like a sold out 30,000 tickets. Yeah. That game had to go ahead. TV was there live, everything. And Football Federation in the end, they transferred players in from State League to fill the squad. So the Knights was a combination of half the team, you know, and then another State League squad players, ring in players. And that was a breach of the rules because the transfer deadline had finished.
Oh, wow.
But imagine that if the game didn't go ahead, it just would have been looked a nightmare. So they changed the rules to make that happen. And I thought, wow, it really makes you feel like you're just a commodity. And for me, I thought Ricky really wasn't looking after the players. In my view, you know, he may feel differently, but I thought he let us down as far as what he did and put us in a bad position. And then
you play in that Melbourne game?
No, I didn't.
Was there an airport standoff?
I stepped off the plane. I didn't travel. I refused to travel.
So you were on the plane, and then on the plane decided that.
I don't really want to go there. It was a bad time for me. I just didn't feel right about doing it. I felt like I was letting down the players that were staying there, my teammates. And it just all felt wrong. So I had a gut feeling, this doesn't just feel right. So I said, I can't do it. And I walked off the plane.
Incredible how, I remember being I was in early stages of working at Oceania Football at that stage, and being a fan and going to those games, and just, you had zero, as a person on the outside, you've got zero idea what's going on behind the scenes.
Yeah.
And like hearing that now and kind of piecing the different parts together is like that's an outrageous situation.
It was weird because like even we got there, all the training gear, all the gear, the chip was all locked away and you couldn't touch it because the club was in administration or whatever it was, and they had to fly over fresh gear, even training gear and balls, and there's the gear because it was all owned by the company that owned the Knights or something. It was just bizarre sort of going on. And very typical, like they sort of went from the stove to the frying pan with syrup pieces, right? And the Knicks, it wasn't quite as bad.
Mm.
But I imagine what was going behind there financially was just the same that was going on at the Knights.
Yeah. So how did that get resolved? How did you get your contract?
Well, it went to the PFA. I was lucky because that's when I signed for Coventry City. I went on trial, at the end of that season. But there's teammates there that didn't, it was guys from Aussie that just went back and didn't play anymore. Jonty Richter played at the Brisbane Roar, and he came to us. There's a few other, without naming names, guys sort of end their career in a way, right?
Yeah.
So I thought that was really harsh. Mm. Yeah.
That was great detail. Appreciate that.
Yeah.
Let's skip to the end of your career, because there's a new life to you now post-football, and it wasn't such an easy transition. I remember there's a few career... You're a lawyer now, but before that you were a Coke salesman and a little stint as a real estate agent. Got you on the front page of the Waikato Times about 2006 or 7. But you spent your whole life playing football. Was there any thought to what comes next during your years, especially your sort of later years of your career? And do you regret in any way not planning for your future? Or how post-football?
It's funny, eh? Like, you are so, during your career, and it's a little bit silly too, because you've got so much time in your hands. I could have been focused on other things. I remember my grandmother used to say to me, "Shane, you should be studying accountancy." And I'd be, "Yeah, right." You think you're unbreakable and you're going to be a pro. You're just spending every moment, you're just thinking about playing and you don't really think long term. And that is a regret for me. Like, I think if I had my time again, I would do what you did. I would go back and go through the American system. I think that is the way to go. I had an English passport, so that makes it easier for me to work in Europe. But it's hard for youngsters going through to get pro contracts. But yeah, no, I think you're a better footballer if your mind's ticking over, if you're stimulated.
Mm-hmm.
I believe anyway. I mean, look at Ryan Nelson, Simon. They went through that system.
Mm.
Turned out right for them, didn't it?
Yeah,
turned out very well for them, in fact.
But it's turned out all right for you.
Oh, right? Yeah. I mean, like, you don't really have any regrets as far as the way it goes, but...
First in your family it would have been nice to graduate, to get a university.
Yes, I think so, yeah.
How was that decision to decide to train to be a lawyer? Because what's that, 5, 6 years?
It was 4 years.
4 years?
Yeah.
What age were you when you decided to start training to be a lawyer?
I think it was 36, I think it was, or maybe the real thing. What are we now? 4 years? Yeah, 36.
So was that difficult? Maybe I'm reinventing myself as a lawyer.
Maybe.
No, not at all. Like, listen, it's funny. I remember starting university as like a kid starting school. Where'd I put my school bag, sort of thing. It was a bit weird going back to university or going to university. But I left school at 17 to pursue the career. No qualifications. That's why we went into real estate. You didn't need any qualifications, right? Anyone can sell real estate.
Mm. Shout out Ross McKenzie.
Is that what he's doing now? Great lad, yeah. Is he doing all right? Is he making plenty of sales?
He's a Dubai real estate tycoon, actually. Been in Dubai for 7 years.
Oh, so wow.
He's doing well for himself.
If you keep an ear out to the pod, we might get him on a bit later around Christmas time.
Oh, yeah. You hear some stories. So then I fell into Coca-Cola sales representative, no qualifications required, and I sort of wasn't stimulated, but I thought, listen, shit, you got to go and get a real job, go and challenge yourself and go to university. So yeah, did that, and the rest is history. Yeah.
Happy now? How's life compare as a lawyer to a footballer?
Mm.
Night and day?
Yeah, it is. Yeah, I'm a lot busier than I was as a footballer, but no, it's good. I love it. I enjoy my job, yeah. Yeah, it's good.
And it's back at Waikato Uni where you start up Woofer.
Waikato University Football Academy.
Yep.
Coaching kind of talented kids in the morning, yeah. And how did that all work?
Yeah, it did. Like, basically, I still think it's a great way, like the American system, and I was trying to emulate that as best as I could in New Zealand. Obviously, we didn't play games, and we had lads. We were training every morning. So anyone that was enrolled at Waikato University could train every morning before their classes, and then we'd have gym programs, you know, things like that, and then they'd play for their clubs, train for their clubs on the weekend. So, you know, I started that, and I did that for the whole time I was at university, and really enjoyed that.
Fun fact, James Bannatyne and I came down one morning and jumped in goals for a woofer session, so I'm surprised that you didn't realise that I did play football, but maybe that shows how badly I was in that morning session. But you had some good players go through that.
Yeah, we've had some good players.
Alfie Rogers, your Wade Maloney's.
Yeah. Scott Hillier, Luke Searle. Who else has been there? I mean, I don't like to miss anyone else. The lad that, what do you think about that? The lad that got done for substances at Wanderers.
Paul Clark.
Yeah, that seems really rough to me.
Yeah. I've been on the wrong end of some football stuff.
Yeah, that seems ridiculous, right? I used to think, I got drug tested, I think about 3 times, and I'm like, seriously, did you just see me play? You're like, as if I'm on, you know, performance enhancing drugs, you know? And like, we're testing young guys at 19, you know, on the bench for National League. You know, seriously, I mean,
Wada actually looking at downgrading some of those recreational drugs from to sort of 4 week in the news this week. I hate to date
keep
the podcast.
Us keep us posted on there through the weeks. Let us know how that.
Yeah, no, I will do. Drug watch.
So at WUFA, you started coaching, doing in the mornings yourself. Now you've stepped away a little bit, but you still go on tours. Or Chris Jackson's involved?
Yeah,
I saw that too.
Yeah. So it's sort of morphed into, like, I kind of want. I think, well, why should young lads go to America and we'll do it here? You know, that's the idea. We have provide this opportunity in New Zealand. Obviously, you can't provide the American dream. So, you know, I thought, well, let's cater for both. And so I started taking tours to America, and this will be the fourth one I've done. I do it every year. And we're going to Las Vegas, Mayor's Cup. I don't know if you're familiar with it. Their tournaments over there are massive. Americans do everything big, and they do it well. So we're taking an under-16 team there, and happened to see Jacko down at the Labour Weekend under-19s, and he's sort of doing a little bit of football, but he's not coaching a team. And I said, Jacko, mate, we've got to get you involved.
How is he? Because, well, publicised, I think, was it last year, talking about some of the challenges that he's had?
Yeah, he's doing really, really well. I mean, I think he's just honest. Like, I can relate to him. You know, you've spent your whole, you're probably the same, like, your whole life you want to be a top footballer, and you play your way, all you've known is football.
You've only pointed at Steve there. Right? So on the field. I don't want to go into that.
Solomon Islands?
Famous.
Did you get a camp or?
No, I didn't have a passport, so that took me on my...
that's probably the better
way. Well, topical as well, but carry on with Jacko.
Oh, that's right, the person that... remember the Declan win? I wonder who blew the whistle on that one.
We've all suspected Chuck for a long time on that. So I'm glad someone finally had the balls to say
that. That may be defamation if we took that. The other stuff is honest opinion.
Well, it's a game of opinion.
What we're talking about?
Jacko.
Oh, yeah, Jacko, yeah. Your whole life you've been, you know, you've just been football, 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 and then it comes to an end. And, you know, it's pretty tough mentally. So Jacko's in a really good space. And, like, Jacko's, like, amazing. You had anything to do with Jacko? Really top man. Really good guy. One of the good guys in football. And he sort of, you know, played his, gave his soul every time he played New Zealand. You know, he was really good All White, in my opinion. And so he's available to, you know, I just mentioned to him, and I said, would you want to do it? And he's like, yeah, I'm keen as. Now, because the reason I love doing it is that, you know, it's like being on the All Whites, you're on an international tour, it's great. I get a lot of pleasure out of it, and, you know, and showing the lads a good time as well. And I thought Jack would be an ideal person to get on board. So we're recruiting for an under-19, so team and at the moment. So we've got a trial this Sunday.
Email
me at woofer.info@gmail.com.
We'll put a link on the Facebook page, maybe get our likes back up after being hijacked this week.
Yeah, there's been a bit of an issue on Facebook. There? Well, we noticed a cyber attack. I don't know if Zuckerberg's onto us or what the situation is, but we seem to have lost 50% of our followers in an afternoon.
Yeah.
So I don't know if maybe the audience just isn't responding to what we're putting out there. But
Are you paying for coverage?
No, we're not.
Often I find it, it's worse. Your likes and whatnot, and your coverage gets worse.
If you are listening, give us another like and a follow, because our numbers have dropped considerably.
Particularly you, Dale Warburton. If you could like the page again,
there's a suggestion that the blokes at the Full 90 podcast have been reporting some complaints about what we're doing over here.
Our popularity,
Eek. There's a bit to go on there. So Buncey, 2010, we spoke about that was your last season coaching National League. Is that flame burnt out? Or is there any ambition to coach at a high level again?
Mate, you've got to, if you're going to coach at a level, you've got to be full time. If you're going to do it justice, you know, you've got to be full, because as I found out, it's more than being a coach on a Saturday and Tuesday and Thursday. You know, your manager, your organizer, your gear man, your psychologist, your everything, you know. And it's if you do it properly, it's a full time gig. Like, you know, National League teams, Auckland City do it right. They train 4 or 5 times a week, you know. And until we get all clubs doing the same, the standard's never going to be where it should be. We're never going to compete with the rest of the world. You know, like, yeah. Wanderers, for example, you know, I hear they do 2 sessions a week. You know, you've got a full-time football coach, should be there. And I may be wrong, but a lot of the players are based in Hamilton now.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think there's.
Why not? Why not train? And if I'm 19, 20, or 25, I'd be wanting to train every day, twice a day. It's what we've got to do, all teams.
It's one of the things you saw at Melville last season. They probably trained more or as much as anyone, 3, 4. Some of those kids might have been doing 5 sessions a week.
Yeah.
And you saw the benefits of it in the second half of the season. They had a really rough start, but towards the end, when they're still going and you've got the teams coming in, it's that professional environment, they got to the Cheddar Cup final because everyone else started to fade and, you know, they lost that sort of drive and that input and that professionalism like you're talking about.
Yeah.
And,
just as far as, like, just developing physically, you've got to be up there with, you know, we're not saying go to the gym every day, but just on the grass touching the ball as well, that develops your muscles and things like that. And just having enough time to work with your players, it seems crazy. I actually think, I know we talk about it's quite topical about the league changing New Zealand, how it's done, you know, if it's franchise, if it's club, you know, I actually think a university system would be quite a good system to have, you know, because they're the players that are at, they've got the time to train full time. They haven't got jobs. You know, look at all the campuses around the country. You could probably get a league within there, you know, and offer scholarships so they don't have to pay. That's how they get paid for playing a game. They actually get scholarships. But anyway, what do I know?
You've got a lot to offer, I think. You need to get you back in the game. You don't see it football grounds enough these days, Buncey.
No. Well, summer league annoys me. I like playing the winter. I've got better things to do in the summer with kids, you know. I've got 3 boys, young boys, and if the league was in the winter, I'd be watching every game.
Yeah. I want to bounce back now, Buncey, to we started talking about this pre-pod, and I want to go back to it because I think there was a good story brewing. We're going to 96, and Nico touched on this a little bit last week, but I feel like, because you were on the plane, party in the plane, back from Wollstone, I feel like there might be a little more to tell on that story. So, what were you, 17 years old? You
and Scott Green, a little bit old, 19.
19 years old?
So, I come back
from Sheffield
United. I come back from Sheffield United, and so I was ready to sort of I cemented myself playing for Waikato. That was the year after, wasn't it? The year after Roger and Eddie were the coaches.
Yes, that's correct. Nico.
Is another good story. I don't know if I'll tell it as a good story, but it was a good incident that happened there. So anyway, we'll come back to that one if we've got time. But so I was ready to go back overseas, and I'd just come back from New Zealand under 23 tour, and I was really keen to move on, so I was having a season there. And to be fair, I think Nico and Darren Melville were sort of thrown into the coaching gig. They were sort of at the twilight end of their career. They would have been about 34. 31.
34,
I think. Oh, were they? Yeah, 34. So Nico was a courier driver, and Darren Melville was a material salesperson, you know, selling, you know, material old ladies.
Linens.
Yeah, yeah. Making quite good money. I think he'd been over to England. But, you know, two great guys, right? Two comedians, if you like. Hilarious, but... You know, they would turn up to training on a Tuesday and balls wouldn't be pumped up and things like that and didn't have cones. And the coach was pushing through his, you know, career van through the boxes trying to find the gear. Starting for... So anyway, so we went on this trip down and to be fair, the plane, you know, was, this is the days when New Zealand football only hired one plane, right? Charter plane. And it would take all the teams, I don't know if you went there, all the teams same, around the country. Yeah.
In the same
so
day.
We were waiting for... Waitakere to get dropped off, you know, from Kennedy or wherever it was, or from Otago first, and they fly back and get us. So, and they got delayed for some reason. So the boys are, you know, drinking up. I don't, as you know, I like zero. I never did drink a lot, like a night out, but I wasn't drinking there. I think me, Scott Granville, and Gavin Pauly were the only ones that weren't drinking.
I find that very hard to believe. 19-year-old Scotty Granville wasn't having a few pints.
Yeah, yeah. Maybe Scotty was actually. Yeah. I think it's some other substances of Scotty too.
Defamation. Yeah. Unbelievable.
Yeah, he's my mate, so what he was. And we were pissed up on that, or the team was pissed up on that. And it was one of those planes, it was an old rickety plane, you know, like you could sort of...
Like that one from Venezuela.
Yeah, it didn't even, it had like bench seats rather than your own seats, you know, the old buckle seat belt. So people were really drunk to start with. And I remember we're about to take off and there's so much noise and that going on. And the pilots were sort of getting pissed. They were saying, like, you've got to keep the noise down because we've got to hear everything as we take off. It's dangerous. You're like, oh, yeah. And then Nico or Melville starts a chant. The pilot is a wanker. So the whole plane is singing. The pilot is a wanker as it's taking off. And like, oh my god! Nico, you might get upset. He started a raffle. You put your name in the hat, and the loser had to take off their clothes.
This is the coach. And get naked. The raffle,
yeah. And so I think it was Daryl Ward that got naked. And then he was so paralytic that he fell asleep naked in the cargo hold. So you could actually get to the cargo hold at the back of the plane. And there wasn't even proper spew bags. People were spewing everywhere, pissing into bottles. They were peeing into the spew bottles, bags. And it was just a mess. And then when we landed at Hamilton, I think we taxied in Wellington or something, and we had glass bottles, and we'd broken glass bottles on the tarmac on the runway thing. It was just an absolute shambles. And I remember the funny thing: Darryl Ward put his clothes back on, and they were on inside out backwards. And he drove into town to get in, and he couldn't understand why he couldn't get into a pub. He was with his clothes on backwards. He's like, "What do you mean? Well, nothing wrong with that." Maybe she had Darryl Ward on here to tell that one. So the under 23 assistant coach was the Napier head coach, and after that he approached me to go and play for, you know, after that. And I was like, yeah, hell yeah, I'm getting out of here, because I was keen. I wanted to progress my football. They're having a good time, right? We'd lost the game. They didn't give two tosses. We were getting drunk, so it wasn't for me. And you know, that's what they were, like I say, great guys having a good time. But you know, and there was some characters, you know, Taffy from Welsh, funnily enough. Chris, I've forgotten his name, but anyway, hell of a guy, played Man United youth team actually. And because I left, and that was in the, as you know, Nico's probably said that was in the papers big time.
Yeah.
And I left, and so a certain Mr. Holloway Senior, sort of, who's a passionate, staunch Waikato man, you know, good on him. He was obviously ticked off with me leaving. I was probably, you know, under 23 international, you've lost a reasonably good player, so he was pissed off, and
his son's a hero.
Yeah, I had to go up to attend a hearing with New Zealand Football about it.
Oh, did you go with
him? Yeah,
because you were the only sober one on the plane.
Yeah, and then he sort of made reference to me being involved, and I was the only sober on the plane. I was like, come on, it's like, mate.
So down to Park Island.
down at Park Island, you played there. And I think we won the Super Club final that year.
And you famously reconnected with Hawke's Bay United in the NZFC days. I don't know if famously is the right word.
Yeah, that
probably
was
not famous.
No, it wasn't good. I was injured. Paul Caton was playing for the APC Rovers at that time as well. So, yeah. So,
injured. Seems cool. Like that injury thing's a real theme running through your career.
I think I had. I mean, you're always injured, right, when you're playing.
But didn't you have
even when you're not playing, Stephen
hamstring.
Yeah.
But you had a really bad back injury, didn't you? At some, when was that?
So that was when I was playing for the Kings. And I went on loan to the Breidablik, the Icelandic club, and then had surgery over there. And
was it a fusion, spinal fusion?
No, it wasn't a fusion. It was just a herniated. So they just go and scrape the cartilage out between it.
Right.
So, but what happened? I played on it too long, you know, and sort of aggravated it. And I sort of.
Did you think about engaging your abs more when you breathe? Yeah. Stephen can share some insights on that.
Yeah. Change his life. Pilates core. That was just coming, and that was just becoming, you know, popular back in those days. Like, you know, everything revolved around doing sort of planking and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Your glutes probably weren't firing.
My glutes weren't. My one glute was slightly smaller than the other.
Yep.
Yeah.
Surprised they didn't pick that up in the
bus trip.
In the movie.
If they had been forcing, they would have diagnosed that.
That's probably what's
taking a positive out of it.
That's probably what gave you away, the lopsided ass cheeks.
It might have been. Yeah. So.
Waikato's most capped All White, am I right in thinking that?
Chris Wood, probably now, right?
Probably 56, yeah.
Yeah, might just eclipse mine.
Yeah. Just.
Good play.
What's happened to our stat guy? You're normally reliable on these.
That was 56 games.
Right?
He'll get a mammoth amount of games, right? I mean, how old is he? What's he? 25 or
26, 20? Yeah. He's still got another 5-6 years, easy.
Yeah.
Especially the way he is. He's not reliant on pace, is he? He sort of can keep going as a target man.
But he's a big unit, though, so you're probably susceptible to...
Yeah. Speaking of big units, I hear you're still playing with Mike Groom, former All White Mike Groom at St. Paul's.
Corinthians. St. Paul's Corinthians.
Yeah. Don the boots. Yep.
How's that going?
Dominant. Love it. Yeah. Groom is the man, eh? Love him.
Striker. Brilliant. Centre back. Where are you playing?
Midfield striker. Box to box. It's great. We just, you know, they play the game that's meant to be played, eh? The beautiful game, Brazilian style.
Yeah.
And Groom is so positive. You know, he just creates a positive atmosphere and. Yeah, we have a good time. I've enjoyed it, actually. I've only played about 6 games. I've sort of been talking to Grimmy for about 6 years and promising, I'll play. I never got around to it. Finally, I did. Real dose of reality, right? My first game back was against a Hillcrest. The Fijian Indian team.
Eastern City.
Mm. So, play warm-up. I was on first... I think I was there on for about 45 seconds and I blew my hamstring. And got subbed off after 45 seconds.
It's real.
Yeah.
Stephen can really empathise
with
that.
Yeah. And then afterwards, you go back, change the room, it's like got pigeon shit all around it. No hot water.
Like, Jensen Park.
I'm like, you know, those who are living the dream, right?
Yeah.
So that was good. You know, paying subs, it's good. It was nice.
Yeah.
Now I'm enjoying it. Yeah, like I said, I might sort of do it again next year. Force you to get out and get fit, right?
Yeah. How's the back and the bottom overall?
Hammy's good now. Hammy came right after a few games off. And
you're looking lean, looking like you're taking care
skinny,
of yourself.
Skinny, but not really, you know. Sit around in the office chair too much.
Yeah.
Your looks can be deceiving.
Do your colleagues know about your sporting past?
Yes, they do.
They do.
They thought it was hilarious that I had a Wikipedia page. They found out after about a month.
Is it like, Buncey, we'll be in the staff touch team?
Oh,
your former
athlete. Yeah. That sort of thing. There's only one other bloke in our firm, so it's predominantly females.
Yeah, you'll be sending this podcast link around to the office. Make sure that they.
Yeah, I should do.
Understand.
Yeah, they might learn some more about me. Yeah. Might actually respect me now. Unlikely, but
yeah. Shay, what else you got on your list?
Do you want to go back to the EDA, Roger Wilkinson, that year?
Yes.
That was a thing that I've never experienced.
Were you there? You were there.
So I was playing for Waikato United. Eddie Edge was a coach, right? This is when Roger Wilkinson was doing his Americans, and he was cracking America with the videos and the movies.
Oh, yeah,
you know,
Wilkinson method.
Yeah,
Wilkinson
took it to America.
Yeah, dads and lads.
I don't know what happened to it, but anyway,
they're still working off the living off the royalties.
Yeah, he might be. They're good videos, to be fair. Yeah, anyway.
I think that was the problem. They never converted them from VHS.
Yeah. It was just bad timing.
To digital.
You just got done by technology.
Yeah, it happens.
Yeah.
I'm still getting the Nokia phones,
right? It's sort of like, you know. Anyway, yeah, so Eddie Edge was the coach and Roger came back, and then for some reason, like Eddie Edge isn't Dick and Edge's father. And Eddie invited Roger, rookie move, in to be co-coach. So you got two guys, two completely different philosophies being co-coaches. And they had this system where they'll do a... and it's funny, I never heard the arguments on the bench, but you can imagine Roger's not backwards and going forwards and voicing his opinion, good on him. And so I knew they had some arguments on the bench over who they would sub. Are you running out of tape?
No, you're good. You're good. Nah, with emails coming through. You know, professional.
Yeah. And then...
I'd had that muted, like your phone as well. It's been pinging the whole time.
My phone?
Yeah.
Now?
No, the whole time. Anyway, look, let's go back to the story.
I'm surprised you've got your phone.
Hey?
Yeah, it's just side recording. So, halfway through the season, it was brewing. You could tell there was argument over subs. And what they used to do is they'd take a session each. So one would not do anything. And it was down at Muir Park. You know, you guys would have grew up.
Yeah.
Knocked around there.
Before my time.
Oh. Yeah. Oh, really?
I only moved to Hamilton in 96.
Oh, did you?
And that's why you were the poster boy, mate.
Great memories of Muir Park.
When did Muir Park get bulldozed?
Oh, shit.
It would have been 95, 96 would have been.
Yeah.
I went
there once.
Melville still got the money for that. What's the deal with that?
Bought the new floodlights. I prefer to talk about that off tape.
It's trust fund.
Yeah. You're actually sitting in the deposit.
For sure, Stephen Holloway.
Anyway, Bruce's inheritance.
So it all came to head one day. It was on a Saturday session before the Sunday game. Eddie was taking the session and Roger was standing watching. So we're in the middle of the session and Roger sort of stepped in and sort of made a comment, like, and Eddie goes, "Rod, you know, Roger, it's my session, you know, step aside." Roger's like, "Oh yeah, you're right." And then you can see Roger pacing. I knew something was on. And in the midst, then Roger steps in again to the session to make a point, and Eddie goes, "You know, Roger, listen, it's my session. You know, would you, you know, go on, get out of it." And he said, "No, I'm not getting out of it." Yeah, and then he's like, "Roger, just fuck off." And he's like, "Nah, I won't fuck off because you're doing it fucking wrong. Everything you're doing is wrong." And then next thing you know, they're nose to nose. So you and me, we're training stop. We're, you know, we're sort of middle of the session. They're nose to nose. They're effing and blinding each other and having to be separated. So here's your two coaches going to have a fisticuffs. And so then the relationship obviously took a turn there for the worse forever. But I just remember that session. Like, it was surreal sitting there when... Yeah, it sort of just built and built, and then it just these two were nose kind of just have fisty cuffs.
How good would a Sam Wilkinson Declan Edge coaching combo be?
Very similar, right?
I remember because I was coached by Roger. Got a very similar story.
He's got lots of stories.
Yeah,
I must have Roger booked in here.
Yeah, no jokes.
We'll
have to get him in. It was around 2007, that Waikato FC season, and he used to. Roger is a bit like you when you first coached. He had a very old school sort of professional style of. He wanted things to his standard, and he was going to call you out on your shit, and he didn't give a fuck who he offended. So he would go around at the start of each training and say what you did wrong or right in the game, and it would be a sort of big circle. So you'd sort of wait for your turn to, you know, get abused.
Yeah,
that's right. Most of the time it was.
Yeah.
And it was young team and Joey Simpkins. I don't know if people remember that name, but he was a built Maori boy. He was strong and probably the one in the squad you would least want to pick a scrap with. Anyway, Rog starts unloading on him. And Joey, you gave the ball away every time you had it and you were out of position. And it was just pathetic. And you can see just Joey just building the building. And eventually he tells Rog to fuck off. Oh, you fuck off. And just like storms off. And then Rog is like, "What you say to me?" I don't want to try to go Rog.
It's a good Rog.
Anyway, it involved them both getting up in each other's faces.
I think I
And Rog, at this time, he must have been late 60s, you know. he wasn't the Rog he once was, but still backed himself against the toughest kind of team. Like, he really wanted to fight, and I think it was Wilkie ended up pulling him away. Dad, you're 68! Come on, you're past it. But yeah, so many stories similar
Rod
to that.
Rog just had a few scuffles. I remember, do you know Rod Campbell?
Yes.
Yeah, poor Rod Campbell stepped in to protect, to stop a fight, and he wore a punch from some old, it was like 68-year-old versus 60, you know, the battle of the handbags, really. But poor old Rod Campbell stepped in to help Roger and took one in the face.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
He nearly got into it last season, too. Do you remember at Wanderers? So Melville Wanderers, obviously, Sam was the coach of Melville this season, and Rog worked quite closely with them.
Yeah.
And first game of the season against Wanderers, they lost in the 93rd minute. And the Wanderers staff and everything, they celebrated, like, as you would, you know, running on the field and derby, the big way. One of the trainers got up in Sam's face and it nearly sort of kicked off.
Oh, really?
So the second leg, Melville beat Wanderers 5-0 at Wanderers. And in the club rooms after the game, I think Rog got a bit carried away. And someone's behind the bar, I can't remember who it was, but he made a comment about, oh, I don't see you celebrating now. This was after, like, an hour after the game. Like,
didn't see you running on the field today. I can't do a Rog either, but yeah.
That was quite good. Yeah.
Still riding the high, and it nearly came to blows. I don't know if there's a headline.
See you out in the car park. Yeah.
Well, didn't they come to blows out at Cambridge? Eddie and Roger again. I still thought that could have got fired up again. I don't know the full specific, again, it's hearsay.
Yeah.
But Roger tripped, apparently. Clotted, he tripped.
Oh, there's so many good ones. And fantastic.
Yeah, good times.
Very good times.
Mm.
Shay, what were you saying? Did that tick off everything you wanted to cover tonight?
I've got two things left on my list, which was with the surname Bunce. How many times have you been asked if you're Frank Bunce's brother?
Brother? Yeah. Well, back in the day, when he was playing, everywhere you went, any relation.
Yeah. Did you ever milk it for...
No, I didn't. I said, like, he's some parts of mine. Like, you know, it was quite pale.
How much are you really getting from milking that your brother's with Frank Bunce?
Well, 1994-95, Frank Bunce was a big deal. Yeah, Steve, you probably don't remember.
No. He was a superstar. He was.
Yeah.
Maybe
you're getting some kudos from being a brother to a superstar.
But you're famously a rugby league fan. Mm. So there's no rugby union.
No, I love my Warriors. Yeah. I'm a frustrated Warrior fan like every...
Is it our year? Next year?
It's our year.
Is it our year?
Oh, no.
2020.
It's all wrong.
Let's go on, Warriors.
Yeah, no. I mean, man, two of Arshik, what a player, right? Imagine having him play football. What, and such a stand-up guy. It seems such a nice, relatable lad. But, mate, wouldn't you love to get some of the athletes that are playing rugby league into our game?
Yeah.
Mm.
Well, when we start talking rugby league with Che Bunce, it's probably time to wrap things up. Buncey, thanks so much for coming on. You've been a great guest. Really enjoyed the chat, and hopefully we'll get you on again and sometime when you've got some more.
When we've got legal troubles.
Legal troubles.
If you want to buy a house, sell a house.
Are you still in there?
You never get out of the estate game.
Oh yeah.
Mm.
We'll talk offline about our agency that we're going to start up.
All right, Buncey. Hey, thanks so much for joining us. And
thanks.